Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sheikh also has his morning session, which is a class dedicated to his book which he has authored. But many of us, we're not sincere. We come here with a different intention, a different goal, for entertainment, to pass time. Some of us even block other people's cars. And I have an announcement, a parking announcement to make. If you have a car BLLX959, please move your car immediately. One brother was trying to leave for half an hour. He hasn't been able to do so. So please move your car. I repeat, BLLX959. But inshallah, the Sheikh Sulaiman Moola here from South Africa will be discussing sincerity on another level, inshallah. And if we're sincere to listen to the Sheikh, let us sacrifice some time in the morning, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, to join him in the Tarbiyah quest. If you have not registered to do so, please go to the back. There's a table and purchase his book and register for the class, inshallah. I call upon Sheikh Sulaiman Moola. Jazakumullah.
I need to introduce you.
No, it's a little tight. That's it.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهديه واقتدى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل إنما يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم من صلى يرائي فقد أشرك ومن صام يرائي فقد أشرك ومن تصدق يرائي فقد أشرك أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Honorable scholars, respected brothers, elders, mothers and sisters, Islam as a whole is a very practical and a simple religion. الدين يسر. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Islam is easy and simple, user friendly. It is practical, relevant and pragmatic. فطرة الله التي فطر الناس عليها. It is in absolute harmony with the human temperament. The very Allah who created us legislated deen. So there is no inconsistency or contradiction between our temperament and the tenets and the teachings of Islam. However, as simple, as practical, as pragmatic as Islam is, there are certain aspects of this deen that are delicate, intricate, and sensitive. And one such aspect that is very, very fine and intricate is the aspect of sincerity and ikhlas. The verse that I recited before you, Ibn Abi Dunya and Ibn Abi Hatim makes mention of it in Kitab al-Ikhlas on the strength of Ta'us rahmatullah alayh, that a Sahabi came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he said, O Prophet of Allah, often I engage in an action with the primary motivation to please Allah, but coupled with that, I have a subtle desire that I wish people also discover my good actions. My primary motivation is to please Allah, but this was how beautiful and honest and candid the Sahaba were. So my primary aim is to please my Creator, but I also have a desire, I wish people also discover this good action of mine. How do you view this, O Nabi of Allah, this active aspiration coupled with the subtle whisper within me? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't respond until the verse was revealed, and then he responded with the relevant verse, and that is the verse that I recited before you, the concluding verses of Surah Kahf in the 16 juz. قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. He who desires to perform good deeds, فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. Then he must do so without diluting that good intent, that good action with any other intention. ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. Do not pollute or dilute or contaminate that action. You're doing something great. Don't compromise its essence with another intention in the equation. Ibn Arabi rahmatullah alayhi used to say that our teacher Allama Turtushi used to impress upon us, and perhaps it's most relevant in the context and the world in which we live, that let not your life slip by in trying to impress your peers and your contemporaries. I have done this, I have achieved this, I have, you know, organized this, I have arranged this. No. Do something discreetly for the pleasure of your Creator, because that is what will rescue you on the day of Qiyamah. Hakim Tirmidhi makes mention of the narration on the strength of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, where the Master sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that huwa fikum akhfa min dabib an-naml, shirk, and that is shirkul asghar, to do things to impress people so people can laud me, praise me, acknowledge me, compliment me. That is more silent than the soundless movement of an ant. So they talk of cancer being a silent disease. It gets into you, into your bones. You don't realize it. By the time you make an active prognosis or diagnosis, it's an advanced stage. Often the desire to impress people, we don't realize how it gets into us. And we don't realize how it tarnishes our actions, how it compromises the effect and the richness of our action. And by the time we realize it, you know what, a chunk of our life has lapsed. وَلَوْ أَنَّ لِلَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ لَفْتَدَوْ بِهِ. Allah says in the 24th juz in Surah Zumar that on the day of Qiyamah, if the disbelievers own the entire world and double that, لَفْتَدَوْ بِهِ, most certainly they would offer it as ransom to rescue their souls from the horror of the day of Qiyamah. وَبَدَى لَهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يَكُونُوا يَحْتَسِبُونَ. And they would be exposed to situations on the day of Qiyamah they least anticipated. Sufyan Thawri rahmatullah alayhi used to say, وَيْلٌ لِأَهْلِ الرِّيَاءِ, وَيْلٌ لِأَهْلِ الرِّيَاءِ, woe be to those who performed any action to impress anyone besides Allah. Nothing but doom comes your way. Nothing but doom comes your way. Muhammad ibn Munkadir jaza'a 'inda al-maut. He goes into a panic state at the time of death. Someone asked him, you were a great scholar, why do you go into this panic? He said, akhsha an yabduwa li min Allah ma lam ahtasibhu. I'm afraid because this ayah says I could perceive myself to be doing good, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it will play out as good on the day of Qiyamah. Abu Uthman says, a good friend of mine, Abu Hafs, had given me a profound advice, and I direct that advice to myself first and then to you. He said, إِذَا جَلَسْتَ لِلنَّاسِ فَكُنْ وَاعِبًا لِنَفْسِكَ وَقَلْبِكَ. When you perform any good deed, delivering any discourse, or you are running any organization, then direct the message to yourself first. Now listen to this. وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكَ إِجْتِمَاعُهُمْ عَلَيْكَ. Do not be deceived by the hundreds, nay the thousands that converge and congregate to attend your discourse. فَإِنَّهُمْ يُرَاقِبُونَ ظَاهِرَكَ وَاللَّهُ رَقِيبٌ عَلَى بَاطِنِكَ. Because they only look at your external, they know no better. While Allah microscopically analyzes your inner intentions. In English they say, the world only sees our actions, while the Almighty analyzes the motives of our actions. So to the world I'm a good man. Why? MashaAllah, that Shaykh delivers a great talk. MashaAllah, that brother is assisting a sister that's stranded. It's good enough to make you noble in the eyes of people. But Allah analyzes, what are you doing? Are you assisting that sister? Or are you preying on her vulnerability? That is why somebody said this in the English language and it blew me off. They say, we would probably be most embarrassed of our best actions if the world only knew the motives behind them. We would probably be most embarrassed. So that deed which society says, wow, it's amazing, it's great. But if you only knew why I did what I did, I would have to cover my face out of embarrassment. Someone said, when you deliver a talk, let it be loud enough that the audience can hear, and sincere enough that the Almighty can hear. Let it be loud enough that the audience can hear, but let it be sincere enough that the Almighty can hear. Imam Ghazali, when he speaks about those who acquire the sciences of knowledge, and he speaks about one category, and by extension, not only acquiring knowledge, any activity of good that we do in. وَرَجُلٌ ثَالِثٌ إِسْتَحْوَذَ عَلَيْهِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاتَّخَذَ عِلْمَهُ ذَرِيعَةً إِلَى التَّكَاثُرِ بِالْمَالِ والتفاخر بالجاه والتعزز بكثرة الأتباع يدخل بعلمه كل مدخل رجاء أن يقضي من الدنيا وطره. The third person is one who acquires the sciences of Islam with ulterior motives. Why? So that he can create a bigger fan club. I've mentioned this recently in one of my talks. For many people today, the yardstick of acceptance for a man is how active is he on social media? How many hits does he have on his Facebook? How vibrant is his Twitter handle? I'm not averse to exploiting social media objectively, but I beg to differ grossly if that is the yardstick with which we define the acceptance of an individual. That is not how the Almighty will judge us on the day of Qiyamah. فَاتَّخَذَ عِلْمَهُ ذَرِيعَةً إِلَى التَّكَاثُرِ بِالْمَالِ وَالتَّفَاخُرِ بِالْجَاهِ وَالتَّعَزُّزِ بِكَثْرَةِ الْأَتْبَاعِ يَدْخُلُ بِعِلْمِهِ كُلَّ مَدْخَلٍ رَجَاءَ أَنْ يَقْضِي مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَطْرَهُ وَهُوَ مَعَ ذَلِكَ يُضْمِرُ فِي نَفْسِهِ أَنَّهُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بِمَكَانٍ لاتسامه بسمة العلماء وترسمه برسومهم في الزي والمنطق مع تكالبه على الدنيا ظاهرا وباطنا فهذا من الهالكين ومن الحمقى المغرورين إذ الرجاء منقطع عن توبته لظنه أنه عند الله من المحسنين. This would literally make every hair on your back stand if you could comprehend the profound nature of this quotation. Where people engage purely to have the limelight. People engage in the activities of deen purely to advance their personal name. And despite having this diluted endeavor, they still appease themselves. No, I'm a good man. People are inviting me. People are lauding me. People are raving about me. So I'm sure I have secured my name in this world and I've secured it in Akhirah. Imam Ghazali says there can be no two opinions on the naive and foolish nature of this individual. And I doubt he will repent because he doesn't consider his wrong to be a crime. When we look into the lives of our pious predecessors, may Allah be pleased with them, they had a greater passion to conceal their virtue than you and I have a passion to conceal our vice. You and I are not so passionate to conceal our wrong to the extent they went in concealing their good. Yahya ibn Ma'in rahmatullah alayhi said, "Ma ra'ayna mithla Ahmad." The earth hasn't seen the likes of Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Sahibnahu 50 sanatan maftakhara alayna bi shay'in mimma kana fihi min as-salah wal khair. I was a close associate and ally of the Imam for 5 decades, for 50 years. In 50 years, I never heard the Imam speaking once of any of his good actions. 50 years I lived with the man, I never heard him saying one thing, I've done this, I've achieved this, I've performed this, I've excelled this year. Muhammad ibn Wasi' rahimahullah, a great tabi'i, he says, Adraktu rijala. I had the good privilege of seeing such men and such humans that a man would retire to bed. Him and his wife would share a common bed, a common duvet, and a common pillow. They would sleep ala wisadatin wahida. They would have a basic discussion, husband and wife, and then they would turn to their respective sides and sleep. While the wife would turn to the one side, the husband would turn to the other side. تَسِيلُ دُمُوعُهُ عَلَىٰ خَدِّهِ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ لَا تَشْعُرْ بِهِ إِمْرَأَتُهُ الَّتِي بِجَانِبِهِ. The man would turn to his side and then he would tremble out of the fear of Allah, and the tears would trickle down his cheeks, but he would contain his emotion that his very spouse sleeping next to him would have no clue that my husband is crying out of the fear of Allah. Today for us to believe that is difficult, but tragically we are victims of a scenario where husband and wife go and sleep on a common bed and they are betraying one another, being unloyal and disloyal and guilty of infidelity under the pretext of wrapping up events and speaking on social media, only to know they're sharing a common bed but zina through the phone is taking place at the same time. وَلَقَدْ أَدْرَكْتُ رِجَالًا. And I also seen people, يَقُومُ أَحَدُهُمْ فِي الصَّفْ, that a man would be standing in prayer, تَسِيلُ دُمُوعُهُ عَلَىٰ خَدِّهِ, and then he would be overwhelmed by the recitation of the Quran and he would not be able to contain himself and the tears would just trickle down, but he would camouflage it and contain it in such a way that neither the man on the right nor the man on the left would have the slightest clue that this man is crying out of the fear of Allah. Hence I said what I said and I repeat what I said, that the pious went through greater extent in preserving and concealing their virtue than you and I would do in concealing our vice. Zainul Abidin rahimahullah, his name was Ali ibn Husayn ibn Ali. He was the son of Husayn radiyallahu anhu, who was the son of Ali radiyallahu anhu. So he was better known as Zainul Abidin, but his name was actually Ali. It is said about this man that he loved giving charity, but he did it under the cover of darkness. When he passed away, his body was brought forward, and when they were given ghusl, they observed that his entire back was scarred. There were marks, distinct marks, indelible impressions on his back. When an investigation was done, it was discovered that in the cover of darkness, this man was providing food for 100 families. Only his death brought his generosity to the fore. This was the kind. حُبِّبَ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ أَعْمَالِ الْبِرِّ الصَّدَقَ فِي السِّرِّ. Amongst the actions on which he was known for was helping through the invisible hand, assisting through the intangible hand, that which no eye seen. Hence Allah gave him the honor and the glory in this world and in Akhirah. When once he was coming to perform tawaf of the Kaaba, and at that time Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, the governor of the time, was present. So people were around the governor and they were respecting him and mobilizing the people and clearing the way to usher the ruler in. And just then Zainul Abidin rahimahullah comes. And as he comes, this august personality, people are just riveted. People are just mesmerized by his presence. And automatically he attracts the extraordinary eye from everyone. And nobody could deny his presence. So someone nudged the king and said, "Man hadha alladhi akramahu an-nasu hadha al-ikram?" O king, it looks like there is a greater king than you. It looks like today your position is in jeopardy. It looks like the stage has been taken away from you. Look at this man, without a throne and without a crown, but people are revering him and lauding him. Who is he? Typical of a king, he plays it down. He says, no, I don't know him. Fly by night. Ordinary guy, I don't know who he is, and I'm not acquainted with him. So Farazdaq, the famous poet, was present. He said, this man, whether you know him or you don't know him, the Kaaba knows him. هذا الذي تعرف البطحاء وطأته والبيت يعرفه والحل والحرم هذا ابن خير عباد الله كلهم هذا التقي النقي الطاهر العلم إن كنت جاهله بجده أنبياء الله قد ختموا فليس قولك من هذا بضائره العرب تعرف من أنكرت والعجم كلتا يديه ضياث عم نفعهما يستوكفان ولا يعروهما عدم سهل الخليقة لا تخشى بوادره يزينه إثنان حسن الخلق والشيم ما قال لا قدت إلا في تشهده لولا التشهد كانت لاءه نعم عم البرية بالإحسان فانقشعت عنها الغياهب والإملاق والعدم إذا رأته قريش قال قائلها إلى مكارم هذا ينتهي الكرم يغضي حياء ويغضى من مهابته فما يكلم إلا حين يبتسم مشتقة من رسول الله نبعته طابت مغارسه والخيم والشيم سبحان الله. If only you could comprehend what has been encapsulated. هذا الذي تعرف البطحاء وطأته والبيت يعرفه والحل والحرم. The Kaaba, nay every brick in the Kaaba, nay the precincts of the Kaaba have been well informed about his arrival and they all anticipate his coming. هذا ابن خير عباد الله كلهم. This is the descendant of Ali رضي الله عنه. إن كنت جاهله, if you know him not, بجده أنبياء الله قد ختموا. His maternal grandfather or his great grandfather brings about the culmination of prophethood on this earth. فليس قولك من هذا ببائره. So your claim I know him not doesn't affect his image in any way. العرب تعرف من أنكرت والعجم. The Arab and the non-Arab alike are impressed with him. كلتا يديه غياث. His hands are wide open. يستوكفان ولا يعروهما عدم. The creation in its entirety benefit from him. سهل الخليقة. Gentle in his nature. يزينه إثنان. Everything about him is amazing. But there are two things I will never forget. His generosity and his tenderness. ما قال لا قدت إلا في تشهده. I cannot recall him ever saying no to anyone. In fact, the only time he says no is when he reads the tashahud and he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, there's no God besides Allah. That's probably the only time no features in his dictionary. Subhanallah. إِذَا رَأَتْهُ قُرَيْشٌ قَالَ قَائِلُهَا إِلَى مَكَارِمِ هَذَا يَنْتَهِ الْكَرَمُ. When the Quraysh look at him, they say, that is a reflection of nobility. يُغْضِي حَيَاءً. He drops his gaze out of modesty. وَيُغْضَى مِن مَهَابَتِهِ. And people drop their gaze out of his respect and his awe. فَمَا يُكَلَّمُ إِلَّا حِينَ يَبْتَسِمُ. The point I'm saying is, زَيْنُ الْعَابِدِينَ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ did that action in such a secret way that only his death brought it to the fore. The narration is in Abu Dawud. The Prophet ﷺ said, ثَلَاثَةٌ يُحِبُّهُمُ اللَّهُ. There are three people whom Allah loves. There are three people whom Allah loves. وَثَلَاثَةٌ يُبْغِذُهُمُ اللَّهُ. The first out of these three, رَجُلٌ أَتَى قَوْمًا. A person who comes to a nation. فَسَأَلَهُمْ بِاللَّهُ. And he asked them, brother, can you aid me? Can you assist me? I'm in a crisis. فَمَنَعُوهُ. They decline and they refuse. فَتَخَلَّفَ رَجُلٌ مِّنْهُمْ بِأَعْقَابِهِمْ. One person excuses himself, he sneaks out. And when nobody is watching, أَعْطَاهُ سِرًّا. He aids him, assists him, away from the limelight, away from recognition, away from praises. لَا يَعْلَمُ بِعَطِيَّتِهِ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَالَّذِي أَعْطَى. Nobody knows about his act of kindness but the Almighty and the recipient of this favor. That's it. Nobody else. I've done it and the Almighty have seen it and that's adequate. Ibn Jarir makes mention of a narration in his Tariq on the third volume on page 128 on the strength of Abu Abdah al-Ambari. He says, لَمَّا هَبَطَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ الْمَدَائِنِ. When the Muslims had descended in the plains of Madain and they were victorious and Allah had given them triumph and victory, جَمَعُوا الْأَقْبَاضِ. They gathered the spoils of the war. Just when they gathered everything, جَاءَ رَجُلٌ بِحُقٍ. An unknown brother came. He had some precious pearls and diamonds. He came and he offered. He said, brother, are you gathering the spoils? Are you gathering the booty? He said, yes, please just take this. So he says, we were present there. We said, مَا رَأَيْنَا مِثْلَ هَذَا. Wow, this is amazing. This is exclusive. This is exorbitant. This is expensive. This is wonderful. We've never seen things like this. مَا يَعْدِلُهُ مَا عِنْدَنَا وَلَا يُقَارِبُهُ. So we looked at this brother. We said, brother, did you pinch anything from it? Did you pocket anything from it? Did you steal from it? He said, لَوْلَ اللَّهِ مَا أَتَيْتُكُمْ بِهِ. If I didn't fear Allah, why must I steal a bit? I would have stolen everything. If I didn't fear Allah, I would have taken everything and off I went. فَعَرَفُوا أَنَّ لِلْرَّجُلِ شَأْنًا. They realized this man was not an ordinary man. He was a man of great stature. He was a man of sincerity and integrity. They apologized. And they said, brother, would you tell us who are you? Would you identify yourself? So at least we know who is the man who did this kind action. He said, وَاللَّهِ لَا أُخْبِرُكُمْ لِتَحْمَدُونِي وَلَا غَيْرَكُمْ لِيُقَرِّضُونِي وَلَكِنْ أَحْمَدُ اللَّهِ وَأَرْضَى بِثَوَابِهِ. I will not reveal my name to you, lest you praise me. I will not divulge it to others, lest they recognize me. But I will praise Allah, and I am happy with the reward that Allah will give me in Akhirah. Today it has almost become a prerequisite. I will assist provided you give me the biggest slot, provided my name occupies the biggest plaque, provided I am referred to as the biggest hero and stalwart behind this event or whatever it may be. Walakin ahmadullah, I will praise Allah and I'm happy with what Allah will give me in lieu of this action. So they were even more impressed. They tagged behind him, they got close up to him, and they inquired from the people who he is, and they said, he is Amir ibn Abd Qais. He is Amir ibn Abd Qais. They had to discover his name from others. He was so humble that he didn't even reveal his name. That was the level of sincerity what he had performed his action. Hakim makes mention of a narration regarding Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that when he was liberating his slaves, at that time his dad Abu Quhafa was not a Muslim. So his dad couldn't identify that why is my son being so kind, because he was not a Muslim. So one day his dad Abu Quhafa said to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, you are being so kind and you are assisting people, at least do this much, assist those and liberate those that are strong, that are muscular, that are robust, so that when you liberate them, at least you can call upon them at the hour of need and they would aid you through their strength and muscle, because your favor is on their shoulders. Subhanallah. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, oh my dad, I try and assist people in whom I do not see the remotest possibility of reciprocation, so that I can take my reward in its entirety from Allah on the day of Qiyamah. When I aid someone, I don't look to see in 10 years from now or 15 years from now, when this child grows and he evolves and he matures, or when this man's business would prosper and it would grow into an empire and he would then acknowledge, reciprocate. No. I try and aid people in whom I don't see any remote possibility of reciprocation, so that on the day of Qiyamah, Allah will compensate me in full. And Allah revealed the verse praising him, وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِن نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى إِلَّا ابْتِغَاءَ وَجِهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِن نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى. He did not offer his kindness to offset any favor, but he did it purely to impress his creator, and surely his creator will be impressed with him. Ibn Jarir also makes mention in the same narration of Tariq on the strength of Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, who says, in the campaign of Qadisiyah, when we were in this battle, every one of us, I looked around in the thousands, every person had a clean intention. Today Allah forgive, if we look around us, then on the reverse, I'm not judging and I'm not accusing, but by and large, to find a man with a clean intention, with a noble intention, has become difficult. And he said, مَتَّلَعْنَا عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْقَادِسِيَّةِ أَنَّهُ يُرِيدُ الدُّنْيَا مَعَ الْآخِرَةِ. I rotated my gaze, and I engaged with my fellow comrades, and everybody was on a common page, and that was to please the Creator. There was no ulterior motive in the actions we performed. We had reservations about three people. وَلَقَدِ اتَّهَمْنَا ثَلَاثَةَ نَفَرٍ. Three people. That is basically Tulayha ibn Khuwaylid and Amr ibn Ma'di Karib and Qais ibn Makshuh radiyallahu anhum. We were a bit hesitant about them. Other year for the right reasons. فَمَا رَأَيْنَا كَالَّذِي هَجَمْنَا عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَمَنَتِهِمْ. But they turned out to be the most loyal, faithful and diligent to the cause. The thing is, what is the motivation with which we perform our deeds? There was a delay in the victory of Egypt. Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu was there. Sayyidina Umar wrote him a letter and he said, عَجِبْتُ عَنْ إِبْطَائِكُمْ. I am really astonished at the delay in the victory. And this delay could only be because there is potential contamination and dilution in your endeavors. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْصُرُ قَوْمًا إِلَّا بِصِدْقِ نِيَّاتِهِمْ. Allah will not aid you or take your cause forward until your intentions are not clean and your motives are not to impress Him. Allah will not take your cause forward. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْصُرُ قَوْمًا إِلَّا بِصِدْقِ نِيَّاتِهِمْ. I often say in my marriage discussions and workshops, the Prophet said, three people are in the care of Allah. And one is that bride or groom, prospective bride or groom, who enters into the sacred institution of marriage with the primary aim of protecting his or her chastity. النَّاكِحُ الَّذِي يُرِيدُ الْعَفَافِ. Often it's the absence of this good intention that we enter into the institution of marriage and infidelity continues after marriage. Why? Because we never intended that I want to become clean, pure, chaste, honest and obedient to the Creator. So we just get married for the sake or for the norm or society. But when the intention is the preservation of chastity, then the sacred institution of marriage would fortify you, would insulate you, would inoculate you, would provide you with that immunization against that promiscuity or vulnerability or susceptible to those forms of crimes and offenses. So what happens? Sayyidina Umar says, I am astonished. And this is only because there is potential change in your intention. وَقَدْ وَجَّهْتُ إِلَيْكَ بِأَرْبَعَةِ نَفَرٍ. And I have dispatched four individuals to aid you. وَأَعْلَمْتُكَ أَنَّ الرَّجُلَ مِنْهُمْ مَقَامَ أَلْفَ رَجُلٍ. And these are not the regular four. These are not the average four. These are not the common four. مقداد بن أسود, زبير بن العوام. And then there was a third Sahabi, مسلم بن مخلد رضي الله عنه. And Aus bin Samit radiyallahu anhu, these four. وَجَّهْتُ إِلَيْكَ بِأَرْبَعَةِ نَفَرِ. I have dispatched these four, and every one of these four equal 1,000 in number. Unless their intentions also change like how yours have changed. What did Sayyidina Umar say? وَجَّهْتُ إِلَيْكَ بِأَرْبَعَةِ نَفَرِ وَأَعْلَمْتُكَ أَنَّ الرَّجُلَ مِنْهُمْ مَقَامَ أَلْفَ رَجُلٍ إِلَّا أَن يَكُونَ غَيَّرَهُمْ. Unless they are also influenced and gripped by the things that have influenced you. When you receive these four people, قَدِّمْ أُولَٰئِكَ الْأَرْبَعَةِ عَلَىٰ سُدُورِ الرِّجَالِ. Then put them in the front because of the purity of their nature, Allah will aid you. And exactly when Sayyidina Amr ibn As received the note, he acted accordingly. And the next day he put these people right in front, and in a matter of a day, immediately victory became their share and they conquered the place with great ease. In Uyun al-Akhbar of Ibn Qutayba, there's an incident mentioned that Maslama ibn Abdul Malik, in one of his campaigns, had surrounded a fort. But for some reason they could not infiltrate this fort. There was a little opening and a niche, and somebody needed to get in to open up the doors for the Muslims to make their way through and be victorious. So some person devised a plan and he managed to get in, and suddenly it changed the entire landscape of that campaign, and the Muslims had victory. Everybody was very pleased to discover that, you know, that there was a hurdle and an obstacle and it was removed. But nobody knew who was the magic hand behind this. Who was the man who facilitated this? So Maslama ibn Abd al-Malik said, the man, Sahibun Naqbi, who facilitated the entry, can he please come forward? We would like to acknowledge him. Nobody comes forward. So then Maslama said, أَمَرْتُ الْآذِنَ بِإِدْخَالِهِ سَاعَةَ يَأْتِ. Whenever he does come, would someone just bring him forward? I need to meet with him. It wasn't long, a person comes up to the butler. So the butler says to him, are you the man who everybody wants to know about? He says, no, I'm not the man, but I can tell you who the person is. He says, okay, anyway, come in, come in. He's brought into the presence of the king. The king again in his excitement, are you the man? Can we? He says, no, I'm not the man. I can tell you about the person. He said, okay, tell us. Before I divulge his identity, he has asked me three conditions. Number one, Allah tusawwidu ismahu, that after you discover who he is, you must not give him recognition on any plaque. You must not gazette his name. You must not write a tribute to him. He said, no, that's fine. We don't worry. Just show us who the brother is. Number two, la ta'muru lahu bihadiyya, you don't make any generous donations or contribution to him. That's fine. La tas'aluhu an ismihi wa qabilatihi, don't ask him more details about who he is, where he lives, his family, his tribe. The king said, we would accept and we would comply with all those conditions. The brother then modestly said, I am the man myself. Now the king's tongue is tied because he wants to ask him, brother, what's your name? Oops. Brother, can I acknowledge you? Oops. Brother, can I? Oops. I cannot say anything. Subhanallah. What extremes these people went to keep it a secret between them and Allah. It is mentioned about Maslama ibn Abd al-Malik, from that day till the day he passed away, he used to make this dua, Allahumma ja'alni ma'a sahib al-naqbi fil jannah. Allahumma ja'alni ma'a sahib al-naqbi fil jannah. Allah, let me be resurrected with this man on the day of Qiyamah. Allah, this man's hidden actions are so amazing, Allah. Can I stand up with this man on the day of Qiyamah? So the Prophet ﷺ said, the hadith of Abu Dawud, three people, أَعْطَاهُ سِرًّا لَا يَعْلَمُ بِعَطِيَّتِهِ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَالَّذِي أَعْطَى. The second person, it also expounds on the element of sincerity. Who is the second person? قَوْمٌ سَارُوا لَيْلَتَهُمْ, a nation who travels by night. حَتَّى إِذَا كَانَ النَّوْمُ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِمْ مِمَّا يُعْدَلْ, and they're tired, they're exhausted, fatigue overpowers them, they retire to bed. Just when they're exhausted and they burnt out and everybody retires to bed, one person excuses himself, قَامَ يَتَمَلَّقُنِي وَيَتْلُو آيَاتِي. He stands aside and he starts praying and worshipping me and supplicating me when no eye can see him. Everybody is gripped by tiredness. Subhanallah, he worships Allah. Amir ibn Abdullah Tamimi. One person from Basra says, I had heard great things about this man. He was the student of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. So one day we traveled by night and we were on a common journey. We halted at a place. Jama'a Amirun mata'ahu. When we halted, Amir gathered his goods. رَبَطَ فَرَسَهُ, he tied his horse. جَمَعَ لَهُ مِنْ حَشَائِشِ الْأَرْضِ, he gathered some food, some herbs, some fodder, and he gave it to the horse. And then ثُمَّ أَدْخَلَ الْغَيْضَةَ وَأَوْغَلَ فِيهَا, he went to camouflage himself where there were a bit of trees and shrubs hidden away, مَسْتُورَ عَنِ الْأَعْيُنِ, where no eye could literally see him, he got inside there. This person said, it started bothering me, what is he doing, what is he going there? So I said, Wallahi la adkhulanna al-ghayda, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to observe what this man is doing. It's night, it's late, people are tired. And subhanallah, I seen when he went into the remote place, he started offering his prayer. Ma ra'aytu ahsan min salatihi wa la akmal. I never seen a man perform prayer more impressive to me than this person. I looked for a little while and then I was overpowered by tiredness and I fell off to sleep. ما زلت أنام وأستيقظ. Occasionally, when I would turn at night and glance, I would see this man is still praying and praying. And he had no clue that I was monitoring him. I'm just like blown away. And that is why I often say, if we cannot perform the virtuous actions, even if we can have a change in our compass where we start respecting or cherishing those who perform good, even that's a step in the right direction. That till today, oh my Lord, I was envious of evil people. But from today, my envy has now been transferred onto people who have rich values and good actions. And he says, I didn't have the courage to perform prayer like him, but in my heart, I was green with envy. I said, wow, just look at this man. Hatta bada subh, until the flush of dawn, until the break of dawn. When it's the break of dawn, he lifts his hands and he prays, Allahumma ha qad asbaha subhu, wa tafiqa an-nasu yaghduna wa yaruhuna min fadlik. Oh Allah, yeah, it's the break of dawn, and people are standing up, and they commence in the pursuits of the day. Wa inna li kulli wahidin minhum haja, and every one of them has a particular distinct need. Wa inna hajata amir an taghfira lahu. Allah, my request by day is the very same request by night. I asked you by night, forgive me. I ask you by day, forgive me, O Allah. Allahumma inni sa'altuka thalathan fa'a'taytani ithnatayn wa mana'tani wahida. Allah, I have been asking you three things for a very long time, and very graciously you have favored me with two and you have declined one of my requests. And it's your prerogative. I cannot challenge you. I am just submitting a request to you again, O Allah, accept my third request. ثُمَّ نَهَضَ مِن مَكَانِهِ. He then stood up. فَوَقَعَ بَصَرُهُ عَلَيَّ. And as he turned back, he realized I was watching him. So he said, أَرَاكَ كُنْتَ تَرْقُبُنِي أَلَّيْلَ يَا أَخَ الْبَصْرَ. Oh brother, were you watching me whole night? I'm like, yeah brother, I've seen you. I've spotted you. Now look at the pious. They said, "Ustur ma ra'ayta minni satarallahu alayk." Conceal my good and I won't reveal your good. And you know, we have this saying, you scratch my back, I'll scratch your back. You don't divulge my evil, I won't expose your evil. And this was like, conceal my good, I won't reveal your good. I said to him, no, I'm going to tell the world what a good man you are. He said, please, brother, don't do this to me. He said, okay, then you must tell me what are your three prayers that you made to Allah, and the two he approved and the one. First tell me the secret, then I won't tell anyone. I'll keep it a secret as long as you're alive. He said, brother, please don't do this to me. He says, I promise you, if you don't tell me that, I'm going to tell the world. He says, okay. لَكَ عَلَيَّ عَهْدُ اللَّهِ وَمِيثَاقَهُ أَلَّا أُفْشِي لَكَ سِرًّا مَا دُمْتَ حَيَّةً. As long as you're alive, I'm not going to tell it to anyone. Number one, لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْءٌ أَخْوَفُ عَلَيَّ فِي دِينِي مِنَ النِّسَاءِ فَسَأَلْتُ رَبِّي أَنْ يَنْزَعَ مِنْ قَلْبِي حُبَّهُنَّ فَاسْتَجَابَ لِي. I had a very difficulty in overcoming the challenge of women and the attraction and the potential evil and zina and all the related vices. And I've been really begging my creator that, oh my Allah, I need to cross this hurdle and I need to go over this challenge in life. I need to mature it and move on. So I've been begging my creator for this for a lengthy period of time, and he has approved my request, and he has accepted my prayer, and Allah has given me the protection against this fitna, and he has given me the strength to resist this temptation. So that's the first prayer that Allah has approved. The second dua, سَأَلْتُ رَبِّي أَلَّا أَخَافَ أَحَدًا غَيْرَهُ فَوَاللَّهِ مَا أَرْهَبُ شَيْئًا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ سِوَاهُ. I ask the Almighty to free my heart from the fear of anyone and everyone, so that I can only fear Him. I may respect others, but I fear the Almighty. And Allah has approved this prayer of mine, and I only fear Him. I said, wow, what's your third prayer? He said, my third thing is, I have asked the Almighty to exempt me from the need of sleep so that I can worship him throughout the night and day. فَمَنَعَنِي هَذِهِ الثَّالِثَةِ. But Allah has denied me this. Allah has denied me this. So I said, brother, go slowly. رِفْقًا بِنَفْسِكْ فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ تُدْرَكْ بِأَقَلْ مِنْ هَذَا. Why do you exert yourself to such extremes? Because surely you can earn paradise without going to such extremes. So he gave such a profound answer. He said, إِنِّي لَأَخْشَى أَنْ أَنْدَمَ حَيْثُ لَيَنْفَعُ النَّدَمُ. I don't want to be amongst those who regret on the day when regret will not avail. I don't want to come up there on the day of the Qiyamah and say, oh my word. Look in the Quran how many places Allah speaks about Ya Layta. Ya Layta in Arabic means, oh I wish, if only I did. Ya Laytani qaddamtu li hayati. Ya Laytani kuntu ma'ahum fa'afuza fawzan azeema. Ya Laytani kuntu turaba. What and what? I wish, if only I did this, I applied myself. I don't want to be amongst those who regret on the day when regret will not avail. So what is the second person? When others are not watching, that is the time he's praying. Ahmad ibn Abi Hawari says that Abu Sulaiman Darani one day told me an amazing thing. He said, my brother, I would share something with you which I won't mention to anyone else. I had the practice of performing tahajjud every night when everybody was sleeping. But one day I overslept. And while I went into a deep mode of sleep, فَإِذَا أَنَا بِحَوْرَىٰ, there is this damsel of paradise standing by my side. رَكَّضَتْنِي بِرِجْلِهَا, she nudges me with her leg. And she tells me, get up. بُؤْسًا لِعَيْنٍ آثَرَتْ لَذَّةَ نَوْمٍ عَلَى لَذَّةِ مُنَاجَاتِ الْعَزِيزِ. Woe be to the eye that prefers sleep over tearing before its master. What about you and I? Our eye is not tearing nor sleeping, but it's perusing porn on the website. Our eye is not sleeping nor tearing out of the fear of Allah, but it is accessing unsavory sites. May Allah protect us. May Allah guide us. She then nudged me and I got up. I was drenched in perspiration. وَإِنَّ حَلَاوَةَ مَنْتِقِهَا لَفِي سَمْعِي. And the sweetness of her reproaching me and admonishing me still lingers in my ears. So the aim and the message is, my brother, do something secretly. That is what would rescue you on the day of Qiyamah. The narration of Tirmidhi, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the earth. So there was movement in the earth. There was movement. Ja'alat tamid. So Allah then created mountains. And Allah pegged the earth with these mountains. وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. Allah created these mountains to give stability to the earth. فَتَعَجَّبَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ مِنْ خَلْقِ الْجِبَالِ. The angels were blown away. Allah, this is such an amazing creation that it has given stability to the earth, Allah. Allah, just by way of curiosity, have you made something more wholesome and more powerful than these mountains? Allah said, yes, I have. I have created steel. وَأَنزَلْنَا الْحَدِيدَ فِيهِ بَأْسٌ شَدِيدٌ. Wow, Allah, steel greater than the mountains, amazing. Allah, and could there be something possibly more impressive than steel? Allah said, yes, I have created fire and that could melt and burn steel. Allah, this is getting more interesting and more interesting. The narration of Tirmidhi. Allah, is there something greater than fire? Yes, water can extinguish it. Allah, is there something even better? Allah says, yes, wind can blow it. Oh my Allah, is there something that is more impressive than all of this? Yes, when the son of Adam can give so secretly with his right hand that even his left hand doesn't know, it surpasses all this in excellency. Ibn Adam tasaddaqa biyameen fa'akhfaha hatta la ta'lama shimaluhu ma tunfiqu yaminuhu. When he can do that and he can assist and aid and support and do it, you know, secretly, then that is most impressive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, there is two things. One is to rave about your good and one is to express the bounties of Allah upon you. There is a very fine line between the two. We've been told that we must express what Allah has given us. If Allah has favored us, if Allah has conferred any bounty upon us, then it is an explicit mention of the Quran. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. Announce, publicize, discuss, express the bounties of your Lord upon you. However, there's a very fine line between that and seeking praises, and seeking acknowledgement, and seeking recognition. Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi has written so beautifully. He said there is a type of lie, there is a type of truth that is disliked by Allah. There is a form of truth and honesty that Allah doesn't like. Masidqul qabih, masidqul qabih, a type of truth that is disliked by Allah. When asked what, he said, thana'ul mar'i ala nafsih. When a person praises himself, even if what you said might be correct, Allah doesn't like that. Allah doesn't like when you praise yourself. Someone asked Sayyidina Musa, and he was a Nabi of Allah, and he was this great human being. He was such a great prophet of Allah. The hadith is in Muslim Sharif, that when the angel of death came to him, and he didn't identify himself, the Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, just nudged him one and told him, back off. So the angel went back to Allah. Arsaltani ila abdin la yuridul maut. Allah, I had the most strange encounter in all my history of removing souls. The gentleman doesn't want to die. The words of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith of Muslim, arsaltani ila abdin la yuridul maut. And Allah said, he is my servant. And the scholars of hadith have expounded and have given all the explanations to it. It's academic. I'm not going into the details. Go back to him. Identify yourself. Disclose your identity. And then tell him that you've come to remove his soul. I'm saying that was the caliber of Sayyidina Musa. And somebody one day just asked him, Man a'lamu an-nasi ya Musa? Musa, who is the most learned? And he said, I am the most learned. And surely, academically, he was the most learned. Because he was the Nabi of the nation. Allah had given him the most amount of knowledge. But the fact that he attributed it to himself, Allah reproached him, Allah admonished him, and then Allah told him that go to the junction of the two oceans and you will meet a man there by the name of Khadir. And he has such a science that you're not even acquainted with the science, never mind the details of this knowledge. Go to this location and you will find a man. And the scholars say all this he had to undergo was purely because he had attributed it to himself. Now can you imagine if Allah disliked the fact that Sayyidina Musa attributed something to himself which he rightfully possessed? When we attribute things we don't possess, how disliked would this be in the eyes of Allah? I make a claim, I chant a slogan, I have a claim, but I don't own this, I don't possess this, I haven't achieved this. I want recognition on the efforts of others. When Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu was salam came in the court of Pharaoh, that's one thing. The second thing that I need to mention here is perhaps we might have a good action, but we need to contextualize that action in relation to all our other wrongs. So brother, you have done a good deed, mashallah. For the last 10 years, you've been observing the fast on Monday and Thursday, and you've been giving your charity diligently and religiously. But why don't you even let the world know for the 30 years before that, you were not even fasting Ramadan, never mind Monday and Thursday. So we magnify our good, we highlight our good, but we don't put it in the broader context of our wrong. Look at the greater picture. And today this is exactly on a micro and a macro level, where you could cause so much havoc and at the same time extend a helping hand to someone needy and allow the media to give it full coverage, that we have the sentiments of humanity at heart and we have the interests of humanity at heart, and this is how we aid and assist. But what about all the other atrocities perpetrated? So when Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam comes into the court of Pharaoh, Fir'aun looks at him and he says, أَلَسْتَ الْغُلَامَ الَّذِي إِلْتَقَتْنَاهُ مِنَ الْبَحْرِ. But aren't you the lad that my intelligence had apprehended while you were sailing in the basket in the river Nile? Aren't you the very lad that was nurtured in my palace? What an audacity that you come and advise me. And he says to him, أَلَمْ نُرَبِّكَ فِينَا وَلِيدًا وَلَبِثْتَ فِينَا مِنْ عُمُرِكَ سِنِينَ. وفعلت فعلتك التي فعلت وأنت من الكافرين. That you had perpetrated so many offenses and vices. Why do you come here and tell us this? So subhanallah, Sayyidina Musa says, take a step back. You're telling me how good you were to me. You're telling me how kind you were to me. Why don't you realize it wasn't a kindness that you did by choice. You were compelled to do this. إِنَّكَ لَوْ لَمْ تَأْمُرُ بِقَتْلِ الْأَطْفَالِ لَمَا أَلْقَتْنِي أُمِّي فِي النِّيلِ وَلَمَا وَضَعْتُ فِي يَدِكِ. You know, I say this on a lighter note. You meet a brother and then you say, I believe you employed by this brother and you're working for him. He says, no, I'm not employed for him. I'm running the whole show there. I'm the manager. Because of me, he can fly and he can travel. I'm taking care of the entire operation there. I've taken his business to a different level. Oh, we've really advanced, grown, developed, and it's gone on a different bracket. You know, he should be grateful to me. Then you meet the boss and the employer and you say, mashallah, I believe so-and-so is working for you. Not working, I'm just carrying him and doing him a favor, man. He's a liability to me. Wow. Subhanallah. According to him, he's doing you a favor, and because it's a family issue and it's an extended relative, so you're just hanging on with him. And according to him, heaven knows what is the truth. According to him, he's running the entire operation. Sayyidina Musa said to Pharaoh, why don't you look at the kindness you displayed? Why you displayed? You had ordered the massacre of children, because of which my mom put me in the basket, and Allah directed the basket to your palace. Had you not ordered the execution of the children, I would have not ended up at your palace, and there would have been no need for you to take me under your arms and under your shelter. And then he mentions this here, and this is what I want you to contextualize. إِنَّكَ عَامَلْتَ قَوْمِي مُعَامَلَةَ الْحَمِيرِ وَالدَّوَابِ وَكُنْتَ تَزْجُرُهُمْ زَجْرَ الْكِلَابِ وَكُنْتَ تَسُومُهُمْ سُوءَ الْعَذَابِ فَأَيُّ فَضْلٍ لَكَ إِذَا كَفَلْتَ طِفْلًا مِّنْهُمْ وَذَلِكَ أَيْضًا عَنْ خَطَئٍ وَجَهْلٍ. That, oh Pharaoh, you've killed, you've massacred, you've maimed, you've paralyzed, you've banished, you've done every crime you can think of to my entire nation, and from amongst them one individual you aided, not by choice but by circumstances. You still have the audacity to laud yourself, to praise yourself, to massage your ego, to have the spotlight on you and highlight your good amidst all your atrocities. And look at that on a micro level and a macro level. I'm afraid this is exactly where the world stands. We want to say the little good that we've done, and that also we don't know how sincere and how accurate, but let's put it in the broader context of all the crimes that we have done. I'll mention one ayah and one hadith, and I would draw my talk to a conclusion. It's an amazing ayah, like every ayah of the Quran. Reflect over the profound nature of this verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draws a parable, a simile, an example of the desperation of the dweller on the day of Qiyamah, of the human on the day of Qiyamah. My words. Allah says, would any one of you desire, that's a translation of the verse, أَيَوَدُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن تَكُونَ لَهُ جَنَّةٌ مِّن نَخِيلٍ وَأَعْنَابٍ تَجْرِي مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Would any one of you desire أَن تَكُونَ لَهُ جَنَّةٌ مِّن نَخِيلٍ, that he has date palms, وأعناب, he has vineyards, تجري من تحتها الأنهار, and there are rivers that are flowing beneath it. له فيها من كل الثمرات. Besides the date palms, besides the vineyards, besides the orchards, he has the luxury of all other fruits and amenities. So you have this rich investment, and it comes to fruition, your investment matures. وأصابه الكبر. And you are now old, and it's just about time to retire. So here you can see all your investments, all your portfolios, it has all matured and come to fruition. Old age has set in, you're just about to take a back seat and relax. فَأَصَابَهَا إِعْصَارٌ فِيهِ نَارٌ فَاحْتَرَقَتْ. You are old, وَلَهُ ذُرِّيَّةٌ دُعَفَاءٌ, and you have these small children. You know, it's my pain, brothers, and I've said it this morning, and I've said it so, we just have not connected ourselves with the Quran. People break their heads to understand things that are not relevant to their field or sphere. It's something that's not within your ambit. It's not something within your operation. If it's something that you need, it's essential, it's important, you need to brainstorm, you need to analyze and understand. But things that are irrelevant and so intricate, why break your head and understand that? Why not channel that time and energy and resources in trying to understand the Quran? وَلَهُ دُرِّيَّةٌ دُعَفَاءٌ. You are old, you have children, you have all these investments, you're just about to retire. فَأَصَابَهَا إِعْصَارٌ فِيهِ نَارٌ فَاحْتَرَقَتْ. Just then comes this whirlwind and this tornado, this gusty winds, and it actually ruins your entire plantation, farming and orchards, and it reduces it to smithereens. There's nothing left. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ. Thus does Allah explain His signs for people who reflect, for people who apply their mind. Now what is the analogy? The scholars say the analogy is the day of Qiyamah. So on the day of Qiyamah, a man would be at his most desperate point. So here is this human being in a situation that Allah has likened. He has all good for him, and when he's about to retire, the entire investment backfires and fails him. Now, to add salt to injury, to complicate matters, to compound the crisis, the Quran says he was old. So if you were young and you lost all your investments, it's a regret, but you can flex your muscles, roll your sleeves and get back into life and come out of the hole and the crisis in which you are. But age is not on your side. You are frail, you are senile. It's not that part of your life where you can go back to work. You've lost your investment and you cannot go back. Number one. Number two, the Quran said, وَلَهُ دُرِّيَّةٌ دُعَفَاءٌ. If you lost your investments and you had no children, you'll say, you know what? It's just myself and the old lady. We break even, eat something simple and move on. But you have kids and they are small, and no parent would want to see their children hungry. This is the verse of the Quran. So the desperation of seeing your children in their eyes is too daunting. How do I face my child? How do I look at my child? And now this investment is gone. The third analogy, the scholars say, Allah says that He had children that are weak and young. If His children were strong and healthy, a man could say, I didn't get my investment, but my sons have, you know, well anchored, well established. They've got their own empires. So I spent 2 months here, 2 months in Dubai, 2 months in France, 2 months in another country. I rotate myself because I have my kids that have cushioned me. The Quran says, no, you have kids that are dependents on you. Now understand, you are old, you are aged, you are frail, you are senile, you have children that are weak and dependent on you. You cannot go back into work, and whatever investments you have failed you. Can the words of any language encapsulate the regret that would grip the heart of this man? Well, the Quran says on the day of Qiyamah, you only had one good action. You didn't have multiple credits to your account. And you invested all your hopes on this year, that this is going to rescue me, that Allah had done this action for you, and it's going to earn my salvation. But the whirlwind that destroyed the orchard of this world was you seeking the praises of people, seeking the recognition of people. Acknowledge me, praise me, laud me, record me, and engrave me, and put a plaque, and whatever else is there. That is the whirlwind that has destroyed your entire orchards of Akhirah. And just like this old man cannot roll his sleeves and get into work, similar will be your condition, because in Akhirah there is no hope nor scope of actions. Can you imagine what would happen to that person? May Allah save us. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes in this manner. He presents His parables. He presents His example. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَفَكَّرُونَ. So that you heed, you realize, you introspect, you appreciate the gravity of the situation. And the hadith with which I would like to sum up and conclude my talk, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu passes by Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, and he says, مَا قِوَامُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ. مَا قِوَامُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ. In what lies the safety of this ummah? What is the formula to rescue ourselves? And he said three things. وَهُنَّ الْمُنَجِّيَاتِ And they will rescue you and protect you from every challenge. Number one, al-ikhlas. Al-ikhlas. Sincerity. Whatever you do, they say sincerity is the face of the soul. Sincerity doesn't need any witnesses. Sincerity doesn't need, the Almighty is watching, that is adequate and that is sufficient. Al-ikhlas. Number two, as-salah. As-salah. وَهِيَ الْمِلَّةِ الإخلاص وهي الفطرة الصلاة وهي الملة sincerity and that is the natural way number two prayer and that is the core of our faith that is the essence of our faith so those are the two things الصلاة importance of prayer إخلاص that is the natural way الطاعة الطاعة to obey to respect and to comply to our seniors our parents our mentors those above us to follow their dictates and their teachings if we can imbibe these three holistic principles in our life then that is the key to salvation we ask the almighty allah to accept our meager efforts we ask the almighty to give us the ability to do things with ikhlas and sincerity I leave you with this quotation that I read it really was thought provoking someone said our life is like a coin you can spin it in any direction you want You can do anything with your life, but you can spend your coin only once. You cannot buy two things with that one coin. You can buy something good, you can buy something bad. You can do an action with a good intention or a bad, but you can only have one intention. Wa sallallahu wa sallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in.
Takbir. Jazakumullah khairan. Inshallah, we will wrap up today's session. Just a few announcements. Inshallah, tomorrow we have the Tarbiyah Quest beginning in the morning, inshallah, 10 o'clock. If you have not registered, please register in the back, in the hallway, inshallah. Also, tomorrow our session, we will have beginning after Salatul Dhuhr, inshallah. So everyone is requested to call your families, friends, relatives, inshallah, and please participate. Jazakumullah khairan. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته